Namaste, my name is Sahara Rose, and welcome back to the Highest Self Podcast, a place where we discuss what makes you your soul's highest evolvement. So I am so excited for today's episode because it is about a topic that I think all of us can relate to. I mean, if you clicked on this episode, I think you can relate, and that is emotionally eating. I know I myself am totally guilty about eating for reasons that are not hunger related. Oftentimes for me, it's just stress, wanting a break from my work, or just feeling the need to have a closure to my meal in the form of chocolate. And my really good friend, Samantha Skelly, is back on the Highest Self Podcast to tell us 5 easy tips to overcome emotional eating. If you missed her first episode, definitely check that out before or after this episode. It's episode 140. 42, Food Emotionality. And in that episode, we talk all about her story being on 50 different diets within a short amount of time, living her whole life obsessed with the foods that she was going to eat, and how later on in life, she realized that it was all because of deeper emotional causes. And she later created the Hungry for Happiness certification program, which we're going to share about on this episode, which empowers people like you and I to stand up and be coaches and help build careers helping other people with food, emotions, binge eating, eating disorders, anything related to that topic. So this episode is for you if you have a mouth and a stomach. Literally, all of us eat for emotional reasons. And the only way that we can truly become healers and help others is if we do the work ourselves. So I get vulnerable in this episode and talk about my own choco addiction. If there's anyone else in the building who can relate, you know how it is. I'll go like a month that I'm not gonna eat chocolate, and then it's all I can think about. And then finally I'm like, okay, I'll eat it. And then I go back on the bandwagon. And we talk about how a lot of that is just related to your own desire to soothe yourself. And it's so much easier to eat a chocolate than to, you know, go to a yoga class or take a bath or do something else. But that's actually the thing that we really need to be doing. And be sure to stay till the end of this episode because she offers us a very special discount for $1,000 off the Hungry for Happiness certification program. And I also have thrown in a special bonus for my 12-week Eat Right for Your Mind Body Type Ayurveda program, absolutely free. So if you're vibing with this topic, it's something you want to go deeper into and maybe make a career out of, this episode is for you. So without further ado, let's welcome Samantha Skelly to the Highest Self Podcast. And before we get started, check out these brands that make Highest Self Podcast possible. I am sure you've heard of CBD oil, but have you heard of full-spectrum hemp oil? See, there are many cannabinoid compounds found in hemp. CBD and THC are the most well-known, but there are many others, each with varying effects. And this is when full-spectrum hemp oil gets involved. See, having all beneficial cannabinoids at your fingertips is like being on a team where all the teammates bring in their own unique skill set, producing what is called the entourage effect. So I'm really excited to share with you Verita's Farms. They offer a full spectrum hemp oil that promotes overall wellness, reduces your stress level, and helps you get more complete rest. Their pure hemp cream also really helped ease my sore, achy muscles after my recent elbow surgery and is great for dry skin. Head over to veritasfarms.com, V-E-R-I-T-A-S farms.com, and use code Sahara for 15% off. Again, head over to veritasfarms.com and use code Sahara for 15% off. This episode is brought to you by Ayurveda. Ayurveda is a modernized Ayurvedic supplement company that takes certain issues that we have, such as mood, joints, immunity, digestion, and creates these custom little packets exactly for us, infusing ancient Ayurvedic herbs with modern vitamins and minerals. I take the mood formula daily. It is great if you work a stressful job, had adrenal fatigue, ever suffer from anxiety or even depression. And it really heals you from a fundamental and holistic level. So if you want to try it out, head over to Ayurveda, Ayurveda.com. Use the code Sahara and you'll receive 35% off your first order. And they now ship to almost every country globally. So check it out. If you live internationally, they may be shipping to your country too. And they just added India, guys. Welcome, Samantha, to the Highest Self Podcast. It's so good to have you back here.
What's up, girl? It's so good to be back. Thank you.
Well, the first question that I'd love to ask you is, what makes you your highest self?
My highest self comes out when I get to love all the parts of me at the same time. I feel this like deep sense of power and embodiment when I can really just like listen to all the versions of myself that are speaking simultaneously and just learn to love them and really inquire about their needs and how I can show up for them better.
I love that. So beautiful. And you have an incredible story. You've been on this podcast before, and I'll share the link in the show notes talking all about your own journey dealing with food struggles, overeating, emotional eating, eating disorders, so many relatable topics that I think lots of listeners have dealt with. But in this episode, we've gotten tons of listeners who wanted to really learn more how to overcome emotional eating, because obviously we eat for way more reasons than just hunger. And I myself, you know, with my wedding coming up, I have definitely seen old habits come back of like, you're not allowed to eat these foods until after the wedding. And then like fixating on only wanting those foods and then binging on those foods and just like, you know, all of your shit just comes out. So I'd love to talk about just strategies to overcoming emotional eating, which is just your jam, what you focus on and what you help other people become coaches in, which we'll share about at the end of the episode. So be sure to stay till the end, because we're going to teach you how to essentially be able to coach others in this topic and as well as overcoming it yourself. So be sure to stay tuned till the end. So you have 5 tips ready for us, which I'm super excited to jam into. I don't know what these tips are. I'm going to be taking note for myself. So let's talk about 5 tips to overcome emotional eating.
So when I think back to, I call this period my diet depression days, where I was on over 50 diets in less than 4 years, and just literally 80% of my day was consumed with that exact feeling that you were just sharing, is like just sort of like the internal talk and the obsession and the never really feeling at home in my body. And after I was a fitness competitor, and it was when my suffering was at the absolute highest. I was a fitness competitor, and you know, I was so focused on the external and really wanting to feel loved, but doing it in all the wrong ways. And I got to this place where the suffering just overcame me. And I realized that for me to move through this and actually change, I need to prioritize my mental health over my body image, which is something that I never, ever did. It was always, body image was the driving motivator for everything. And my whole life surrounded that. So everything was driven by fear. Everything was driven by this deep, deep, deep fear of gaining weight, because that for me meant I was unworthy, unlovable. So it was so deeply rooted. And so I got to this place where I was like, all right, something needs to change. And the first thing is I needed to get so incredibly honest with myself. I have a tendency to, because I'm a fairly positive person, to put on this mask that just everything's awesome all the time. And I was doing that to myself. So I woke up and I'm like, everything's great. I'm not struggling. It's fine. It's fine. It's fine. And I would constantly discount my struggle and constantly discount this pain that I was experiencing in my body. And so first, the first thing I needed to do was look at it for exactly how it was. I'm talking to myself in the third person, like, Sam, you are struggling right now. You are trying to validate your worth through your body. You're in a fight with food. You hate your body. You're hating yourself right now. And that's okay. Can we accept that? Can we just be honest? Because transformation cannot happen without being honest and truly accepting it for what it is. The second thing I got to really shift was changing my relationship to pain in my body. For so long, and you know, this is a constant story, whether it's physical pain or emotional pain, we're like, get rid of it, it's got to go. And what we get to realize is pain is such a catalyst for growth. Pain is the portal to the truth. And when we change the relationship to pain and we realize that it's just data, it's just, that's all that is. It's sensation and it's data and it's information letting us know that there's something out of alignment. And when we can listen to it and we can be attuned to it and not suppress it or not numb it, then we can really begin to shift it. And so that requires us to observe it, not to identify with it. So for so much of my life, especially going through this time when I was deeply struggling with emotional eating, binge eating, the whole bit, I would always say, I am anxious, I am anxious, I am anxious. And I would so identify with that sensation, with that frequency. And it didn't give me any space to move through it and to transcend it because I felt like I was in the bottle with it. I would feel anxious and I'm like, I'm just an anxious person. And I would live my life that way. And then I realized I need to observe it. I need to observe the pain and ask my body what it needs, you know, similar to the first question of like viewing that as a part of me. It doesn't own me. It doesn't consume me. It's just a part of me. And so changing my relationship to pain, knowing that it is happening for me and it's happening for a purpose. The third thing, and I alluded to this in number two, was really looking at all of the identities I've chosen for myself with a fine brush comb, whatever that saying is, like really being so meticulous about what are the identities that I am choosing to put on myself that are ultimately out of alignment with who I actually am. And, you know, the whole I am anxious thing was just an identity that I've chosen to embody and live out. And a lot of people who struggle with emotional eating choose identities for themselves, such as I have no willpower. I'm just the fat girl. I can't do this. I don't have the strength to do this. I have no power, whatever it is. And so look at the identities that you may be holding on to right now. Even as you listen to this podcast, just take note of them. What do you believe to be true about yourself? Because identities drive behavior. Identities drive everything. And so when we can destroy the identities that are no longer useful and create identities that are aligned with where we want to go, everything begins to shift and change. So even in my life today, I'll look at my financial situation, my relationship, my business, my money, everything. And I'll go, what is showing up that isn't in alignment with what I know to be true? And then I'll ask myself, what's my identity around that? What's my story around that? And then I'll begin to ask myself, what is the reality of what I want in this area? And what is the identity that goes with that reality? And so really looking at it for what it is, again, going back to number one, being honest about your identities and then extracting them and figuring out which ones are keeping you stuck in this cycle of emotional eating. The fourth thing is we get to feel in order to heal. You know, again, we need to change the relationship to pain, but then we need to also show up for the pain and really feel it and really be in it. And again, feeling it without it consuming us. And that's something that a lot of people, when I teach this, they're like, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I could actually feel my pain and for it not to overwhelm me completely. Oftentimes, we're afraid to feel for a few reasons. Number one, we don't feel safe in our body. We feel like we're going to feel the pain and it's going to be too much and we're not going to be able to handle it. So there's a lot of stories as to why we can't do this and we can't feel the pain. And my invitation to you is allow yourself to just settle into the sensation that's present because it's happening for you and it has a beautiful gift. There's so many gifts within pain. We just need to settle into our bodies and truly feel it and stop running from it and hiding from it. And food, of course, is the way that we do that. We feel the pain and we go, I don't want to feel this anymore. I'm going to dig into the Ben and Jerry's or the Cheetos or the bread or whatever it is so that I don't feel this pain. Well, my love, that is the exact gift that is bringing you, is for you to feel it and to understand why it's there so that you can love it and then we can transcend it. The fifth and final little tidbit I want to share today is intention behind consumption. So a lot of women will ask me, Sam, I just don't know if I emotionally eat. I just really love food, or there's that conversation. And my reflection back and the inquiry that I choose to give people is, what's the intention behind consumption? When you choose to put something into your mouth, there's four reasons we do that: health, hunger, enjoyment, and numbing. Right? So emotional eating oftentimes would be in the fourth category of numbing. But then there's also this category of pleasure. We can use food to enhance experiences, and it's not because we're trying to numb a sensation that we're choosing to not feel. We can use food in a very intentional way. And so emotional eating to numb pain is not a great strategy, but using food in ways that nourish our bodies and allow us to extract more joy from life is a beautiful thing. So same thing with wine, right? We can use a glass of wine at the end of the day to numb the feelings that are in our bodies. Or if we are, you know, you're going to go to on your honeymoon with your husband and maybe, I don't know if you drink or not, but say you did, you want to have like a glass of wine to like enhance the moment. You're not trying to run away from anything. You're not trying to suppress anything. You want to enhance an already pre-existing beautiful moment. So really checking in and asking yourself, what is my intention behind consumption? And then also this really relates back to number one, with just being so honest about it and loving yourself and accepting yourself for exactly what it is in the moment. So those are five little things you can do.
Oh, so good. I mean, there's just so much to dissect in all of them. So I want to make this super like pragmatic of situations I've been in that I feel like other people have been in. Mm. And how to like troubleshoot them from an expert. So oftentimes I feel like we eat something and we think, oh, well, this is just to enhance the moment. For example, you're out to lunch with your friends and they all decide to order a dessert. You didn't really want the dessert, but you're not going to be that person who's like, oh, I'm not going to eat it. So you just eat it anyways. Mm-hmm. And then from that, you know, it's the sugar is in your mouth, you get the taste, and then slowly, slowly you start to be that person who wants the dessert. So how can we have boundaries around food without being that like crazy person or not partaking in social events because we're afraid of the food involved?
Yeah, absolutely. So I want to share a quick story because I think this is just so relevant for this question. I was with my boyfriend, we were at a cabin the other day, and he's like, oh, I just want a bagel so bad right now. And I was like, oh, that would be awful. He's like, you don't like bagels? And I was like, I just don't enjoy the way that they make me feel. And he's like, is that how you judge food? And I was like, yeah, based on like how it makes me feel after I'm done eating it. And he's like, what about when it's in your mouth? And I'm like, yeah, it's good. But the cost for me is so much greater than the small jolt of enjoyment. So that is like a really interesting framework that has been really helpful in just like navigating, is this really good for your body and really checking in with your body? And I don't like the good food, bad food situation at all, but it's what is best for your system? What is best for your body? And your body knows, always knows. If you really deeply check in, does your body actually want that chocolate cake? No, probably not. But if you're doing it just for pleasure and you're choosing it intentionally and you're being aware of it, it's not a bad thing and you shouldn't shame yourself for it. It's when it becomes mindless and the intention is to, I gotta just fit in because everyone else is doing it, or I just want to take the edge off or whatever it is. So really checking in, number one, with how is this going to make you feel after? And what is the ultimate goal? For me, my ultimate outcome and goal with food is I want the highest amount of vitality and nourishment and to feel amazing so I have epic energy all day long. Okay, well, I'm going to choose food under that filter versus what is going to give me that quick hit. The second thing is really get clear on what emotionally is that food fulfilling, right? So is it fulfillment? Is it excitement? Is it just feeling connected to your friends because you feel like the odd one out? And how can I create those frequencies and experiences in my body without anything external?
So beautiful. And I feel like oftentimes when one person speaks out like, oh, I actually feel really dehydrated or really tired after I have that, other people are like, me too.
Yeah.
And then it's like, then why are we doing this? But it's almost like you feel like it's a shared experience for everyone to come together and like eat chocolate or pizza or whatever it is that, you know, like in high school, you'd go over to your friend's house and just like eat all the junk and people would actually like think you were anorexic or something if you weren't eating all the junk food. So I feel like we have that like fear in our heads of being labeled as eating disorder that we're like, oh, I have to eat to fit in and seem normal and make other people feel okay.
Yeah, absolutely. So then you get to ask the creative part of you, if I was to create the same experience that food was bringing in, what would that be? And how could I powerfully create that? And then we get to explore, right? Because it's, I mean, we live in a world where like social, like being social and food just go together. Same thing with alcohol. Well, that's like just to options. There's so many other options.
Totally. So many other options, and going on a walk with your friends, or, you know, writing poems together, or whatever else. It doesn't just have to be meeting to eat.
Exactly.
I feel like a lot more people, I mean, especially in the dating world, I feel like a lot of people are doing that, and we should do it with friendships too.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I lived in Cambodia for about a month, a couple of years ago, and just like observing the people there and like how they connect was so incredibly inspiring. And, you know, the things that they did to connect and to feel those connections, those feelings of connection and fulfillment and just being a part of something. There's so many other options, but in, you know, North America, we've decided that food is going to be the thing.
Totally. And I think, you know, and it does happen in other cultures, like in Europe, there's a lot of it too, but I feel like people are a little bit slower and more intentional that they don't end up binging. Whereas here it's like you go to the Cheesecake Factory you eat as fast as possible because there's a table waiting.
Totally.
And it's not even, I mean, I see like oftentimes when I hang out with like my fiance's family and stuff who are not into this, and it's like everyone just like wants to be with each other, but they're just eating and not even talking. That it's like, what is the point? We're all at this dinner, like waiting for the food impatiently. And then the moment food gets there, everyone scarfs down their food and then they're like uncomfortably full. Mm-hmm. And it's like that wasn't even social interaction.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. It's really about, again, it's about being intentional about everything, right? Even coming down to like the experiences of like, we are so deeply, like we're starved for human connection in this world. And that is literally all we want. We want to connect. We want to serve each other. We want to be around each other. We want to look people in the eye and be present with them and just feel those like nourishing feelings and energies of just like pure connection. Well, we've just kind of like screwed it up a little bit, right? So being clear about like, this is the outcome that I want. What are my strategies of getting there? And are these strategies working for me? And are they actually effective?
So good. Who else has tried FabFitFun? Well, if you don't know about it already, it's a seasonal box with full-size beauty, fitness, and lifestyle products. The box I received is pretty epic. It has quality brands like Anthropologie, Free People, amazing skincare products, Tarte, Kate Somerville, and that's just the beginning of it. So don't miss out because they sell fast. Check out FabFitFun.com and use code Sahara so you can receive $10 off your box, making it only $39.99. Again, head over to FabFitFun and use code Sahara. You deserve to treat yourself. Okay, real talk. The product I'm about to tell you about is literally the best thing I've ever put into my mouth. And that is saying a lot. And this is Organifi's Gold. So essentially, it is the hot chocolate of your dreams with none of the sugar and all of the turmeric and reishi with a touch of ginger as well. It is delicious on its own just with water. When I was on my Pancha Karma and I couldn't have any sugar or chocolate, anything like that, I brought my Organifi Gold with me. Pancha Karma approved, and all I needed was hot water, and it was the perfect, just sweet, soothing, desserty taste that I so deeply crave after meals. And it makes me feel so calm, so restorative. It is my optimal nighttime tonic, and literally I've gotten all my friends on it, and I'm pinching myself that they are my podcast sponsors, because even if they weren't, I would still be telling everyone about it. So head over to Organifi.com and use coupon code Sahara for 20% off. That is Organifi, Organifi.com. Use coupon code Sahara for 20% off your gold. Now, I want to talk about, a lot of us crave something sweet after our meals. I know I am totally one of those people, and I don't know if it's just like you're used to it or whatever it is, but you want a little bit of chocolate or a coffee or something. Would this be considered emotionally eating because you're not hungry for it? You just want that taste?
This comes down to purely habit. This has been ingrained in us as a culture. We eat and then we have dessert. We eat and then so on such a deep, deep, deep level, this is like the pattern. And I used to always say, I just have to have like a piece of chocolate after I eat. I have to have something sweet. I have to have a coffee. And then when I, going back to point number one, I got really honest with myself and I said, is that actually what I'm craving right now. What am I really craving right now? And oftentimes, here's what it was for me. I ate too much that I was at the place of just being super, super full. And so I wanted a state change so I didn't feel like this like ugh feeling. So then I would use more food to change my state. And so it really comes down to it's a habit. What's what we always do, what we've always done. And it's less about the food and more about changing our state.
I love that. Mm-hmm. So I find myself sometimes like when the chocolate, when I know I'm going to eat, I'll be like, oh, I don't want to get myself too full because I want to have chocolate after. Whereas sometimes when I feel like I don't have the chocolate, then I'm like, like it's over, you know? Mm-hmm. I feel like I want to just keep eating. And that's why I look forward to the chocolate, but it's totally not a physical need, but it's such a strong mental one.
And emotional. So it's an emotional need that your mind has distorted to think that it's a physical one. Does that make sense? So that's like the interesting little loop. It goes from like emotional to mental and then to physical. But we can keep it on just the emotional and not let it jump up to the mental to change the story. And so what that would look like in like a practical way is getting clear, asking yourself, what is it that I most need right now? And the first thing that came into my mind just as I asked myself that question now is like soothing. I just want to feel soothed. Okay, if I was to create the sensation of soothing in my body right now, what does that look like for me? And then follow that. What comes into my mind? I'm a very visual person, so I get like shots of like images when I ask myself questions. It's like a bath. All right, cool. Let me go do that. Let me go have that bath or read that book or go for that walk or breath work or meditation or reading or connecting or whatever it is. But it's really about keeping it in the body, not letting the mind take over and making it something that it actually isn't at all and fulfilling that need on an emotional level.
So true. And I feel like food is just like a quicker cop out than actually taking a bath or actually taking a walk. Yeah. Like, oh, that could take me half an hour. Whereas eating this chocolate will take me 3 seconds and then I can keep on working.
Exactly. 100%.
Sometimes I'll even catch myself, like I'll usually have like a tea tonic type thing with the chocolate. And sometimes I won't even want to wait until the water is boiled and I'll just like inhale the chocolate that I'm like, okay, I'm in some real need of soothing when I can't even wait for water to boil.
Yeah, that's so interesting. My boyfriend and I were having that conversation the other day because he was saying the same thing. He's like, I just find myself going to the kitchen and what am I doing in the kitchen? Like, what's happening there? And it's like, you know, we want a relief. Our nervous systems are like, all right, give me a different experience right now. I just want something different because we're glued to our computers doing whatever, right? So it's like, what experience does our nervous systems want from us that doesn't include food?
Yeah. And I think it's just honestly a break. And that if our brains tell us that we're hungry, then we'll stop and we'll take that break. Whereas if it's like, oh, I'm just going to go like lie down and stretch on my floor. We're like, no, I don't have time for that.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's like, what is like the quickest thing, the quick hit? Yeah.
So, and now I want to talk about, now there are a lot of people who like late at night, they're secretive eaters and they'll really just go to town and eat. And I remember I used to work with some people like this and it would be really astonishing. I couldn't even imagine how they would fit so much food into their bodies. And oftentimes would be a particular food, like a particular food from their childhood or like a random type of taste, like just tomatoes or something. Mm-hmm. And it was clearly not a hunger related things, but almost like a trance-like state that they would get into.
Absolutely.
So what can you share with about overcoming that?
So it almost is like a hypnosis. And then you sort of come to and you're like, oh my God, what have I done? Like that's sort of the feeling of it. What we need to realize in those moments is what our body is really asking us for is a state change. What I did in those moments, because that's the most vulnerable place an emotional eater can be, is at the verge of a binge. And I'm sure as I'm saying this, those people that are listening that our emotional eaters, you can kind of feel that energy in your body. It's like, it's almost as if your body is just completely taking over and you have no control. And what we need to be clear on in those moments is number one, you have complete control and you get to calm down your emotionality so it doesn't have an impact on your behaviors. And what we get to get clear on as well is, what is the state change that I'm truly craving? What am I actually hungry for? And changing our state can happen in so many ways, but doing just breath work, just like even just like fire breath, like that will change our state. Like in through the nose, out through the mouth will change our state. Moving our body changes our state. Connecting into our body, getting into our core, getting into our heart can change our state. Even just asking ourselves, if I was to make my next decision from my heart, not my head, what would it be? And that's just a beautiful, quick, and easy question to change our state when we're on the verge of that 2 a.m. binge into the Ben and Jerry's.
So good. I love that. If I could ask my heart, not my head, what would it be? I mean, just in for everything, I think, you know, and it would say rest and be easier on yourself and love yourself and
so true.
And take care of that inner child. And that's really all that this is about.
So true, girl. There's this beautiful quote. It's not mine. I don't know whose it is, but it says, think with your heart, love with your mind. And I'm like, that's everything, you know? What if we were to just think with our heart and we put a lens over the world and ourselves, and we viewed ourselves with love and viewed the world with love and viewed others with love and viewed our inner children with love, you know? It would just absolutely change the game.
So true. Well, I find this work that you are teaching so important because we can only help the world when we help ourselves. And so many beautiful healers, mothers, all sorts of people in all types of walk are dealing with this, and it's holding them back from really living up to your ultimate dharma. You know, when you're all you can think about is food and worrying about it and obsessing over it, you don't have the space needed to fulfill your soul mission on this planet. So please, if this is something that's resonating with you, if you're dealing with emotional eating, eating disorders, anything food related, and I think most of us, especially in today's society, have something going on, please, please, please look into Samantha Skelly's work. And she has created this incredible certification program that has been running for a number of years, certified many, many people that I love connecting my audience members to. And it is called the Hungry for Happiness Program. So this is a program that is a year-long certification program to become a Hungry for Happiness certified coach. And you will be able to, first of all, work on your own relationship with food. And secondly, empower yourself to become a healer and a coach. So you are able to help others with their food journey and create a career for yourself, empowering people in this very, very sought after topic that so many people are calling out for help with, and there just aren't enough people to do it. So can you tell us a little bit about Hungry for Happiness?
Absolutely. So I was a personal trainer for 7 years, and I realized that, you know, we have so much work to do in the way of waking up. And there's conversations that are going on around this all over the place. And it's really time to open our eyes to what is really happening. And when I was a personal trainer, people would come to me and they would want to lose weight and they would want to feel better, look better. And what they were actually wanting was not that at all. But I was giving them meal plans and exercise plans. And I was really putting band-aids on bullet wounds and not looking at the core reason as to why that woman or that particular person was overweight, overwhelmed, struggling. And it was so much about unworthiness, so much about not feeling good enough. And I was going through this at the same time that I was a personal trainer. And I just realized we need an epic change in the world when it comes to health. We need to stop just thinking about health as one-dimensional and know that it's driven by our emotions. It's driven by something so much deeper. And rather than focusing on behavior change, which is not sustainable, and eventually our biology overpowers our, you know, our ability to stay on a plan and stay on a regime, we need to get to the core reason as to why we feel unhappy in our bodies, why we feel unfulfilled, why we're using food as a drug, why we hate our bodies, why all of that stuff. And when we start to work at an emotional and energetic level, we begin to shift into who we actually are, our true selves. And we're not constantly wearing masks and living lives that are not in alignment with who we are. And so my big mission right now is just to empower every single, because health coaches, wellness coaches, people who are helping others are at the forefront of this work, right? People are coming to them because they want a change in their lives, and we're not helping them at the level that is possible. And so my whole mission right now is to give all wellness coaches, health coaches, people in the world, the tools and the ability to really create sustainable transformation so that that individual becomes more impactful and their clients' results are just through the roof. So that's the mission of Hungry for Happiness, is just teaching people these energetic and emotional tools so that they can really make a huge difference and impact in the world.
I love that. And it is such an important mission. Thank you so much for rising up to the call and sharing it. And for anyone that wants to join Samantha on this mission, more of us are needed. She is offering $1,000 off the Hungry for Happiness certification program. So not only will you receive $1,000 off, but because I am so supportive of this work, you will also receive my Eat Right for Your Mind Body Type 12-week guided Ayurveda program absolutely free for joining, because Ayurveda goes hand in hand with this work. And like we talked about on the last podcast episode, the doshas are also related to eating disorders, vata anorexia, pitta orthorexia, kapha, emotional binge eating. So when you're able to have knowledge of both and see how they can go hand in hand, you can really work with clients and help them on such a holistic level. So you will receive $1,000 off and my Eat Right for Your Mind Body Type program absolutely free by heading over to hungryforhappiness.com/Sahara. That is hungryforhappiness.com/Sahara to receive your $1,000 off discount and the 12-week program absolutely free. They have their next start date starting in July. This is not a program that runs every single month. This is a program that you're really going to get to know the people in your class, Samantha. They even do your annual live graduation ceremony. Yeah. So it is something that is really, really hands-on. And even if you're not sure if you want to be a coach or helping other people doing it, Samantha was saying that about 20-30% of people just sign up just to help themselves and just to work on their own healing. And, you know, we could all use work on ourselves. No one is immune to that. And I definitely want to come to one of your graduations for sure, because I want to meet these powerhouses in this program.
It's so cool. They're actually coming in tonight, which like makes me so, so, so incredible. So we just completed another 10-month journey and I just can't wait to meet everyone. So cool.
So epic.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Samantha, for sharing all of this incredible healing, powerful modalities that is transforming so many lives, and for making the Hungry for Happiness certification program available so more people can step up into careers doing this.
You're so welcome, love. And thank you so much for being such a beautiful supporter. I can feel your love and support. So thank you for sharing this with your amazing community.
Oh, thank you so much. Namaste. Oh, I just adore her. Good vibes all around. She is so real, so hilarious, and just knows truly the intricacies of why we make these choices that we make of, oh my God, I know I'm really not supposed to order a cheesecake right now, but I really want to, and why we're doing these things. And I feel like it's something that no one talks about, that we're all being controlled by our cravings. I mean, how many of you have gone out of your way to go to a restaurant or a bakery or something just because you were so craving it? And it can make it feel like your body is in control and you're just like the ghoul that has to follow along. And it's not the case. It's actually just the emotion that is creating this addiction. So if we can get to the root of the emotion of, okay, it typically happens at the end of a day when I'm burnt out and I haven't given myself any breaks and I'm feeling like I need to, you know, break off from society, and that's when I go into my binge eating trance. Then that helps you understand how you can prevent it happening again. Because guys, we can try all the diets, we can, you know, replace it with this keto milkshake or whatever, but it's not going to get to the root of the issue until you're able to address the emotion. Now, if this is the kind of work that you're ready to dive into and help teach others, please, we need you. The world needs you right now. There's such a high demand for people doing this kind of work, whether it's in doctor's offices, your own personal practice, online, YouTube, Instagram, everywhere, because all of us are dealing with this at some level, and we need more experts who've done the work themselves that can facilitate this revolution of healing our relationship with food for everyone. So head over to hungryforhappiness.com/Sahara, and from there, you'll be able to chat with one of the members of her team. They've all undergone the program themselves. They can answer any of your questions, and you can sign up for the next start date in July and get started on your career as a Hungry for Happiness certified coach, as well as experience my Ayurveda program absolutely free. Again, that is hungryforhappiness.com/Sahara. I look forward to seeing you on a future episode. And if you loved this episode, I would love if you could leave me a review in the iTunes store. And as a free gift, I will share with you the first half of my unreleased book, Eat Right for Your Mind Body Type. Simply email a screenshot of your review over to sahara@eatfeelfresh.com. Again, Sahara, S-A-H-A-R-A, at eatfeelfresh.com, and I will send you over the first half of my unreleased book, Eat Right for Your Mind Body Type. Thank you, and namaste.